If you're anything like me, you've always wondered how all of your data is kept safe on the internet. Like, who hides my passwords, private messages, and credit card info from the hackers who peruse the web? You know, the dangerous ones, who leave no trace behind, who could know anything and everything about me at the touch of a button. Like, the infamous... Alright, enough jokes. The data is kept safe from real threats using encryption. If you don't know what that is, you're in luck. I'm making this video because I don't think enough people understand how encryption really works. I mean, your privacy completely depends on it. And right now, when the legal decisions about digital security are being made for the first time, it's more relevant than ever. So let's get to it. Encryption is jumbling up your data before you send it to the recipient so that if someone steals or copies it, they don't know what the data is. Facebook, Google, Apple, and most other big companies use encryption to keep your data safe. Each time your computer or phone sends them anything, it encrypts it first, and so do the companies before they send something back to you. This protects it from hackers. So, how does all this work? There are many types of encryption, and I'll be going over three. The first two will help you understand, like, the fundamentals, and the last one explains how internet security works today. Also, if there's something expanding on what I'm currently talking about that I've linked to in the description, it'll show up in a red border. So, look out for those. Encryption is best explained with the help of three people. Plus, if you want to study it further, explaining it this way will keep things nice and consistent. Here's Bob. He's very special because he's really easy to draw. Here's Alice. She's a bit paranoid, but very smart. And here's Eve. She's the internet's biggest gossip. She's always trying to get her hands on everyone's secrets, and she shows off whenever she cracks someone's security. Any transfer of data between Alice and Bob has to take place through the internet, where Eve immediately gets a copy of whatever they sent. There is absolutely nothing that you can put online that Eve cannot get a hold of. On the web, everything is at everyone's fingertips, whether you like it or not. CGP Grey has a great video about this concept. Remember,
for on the internet, there's no such thing as distance.
First, Alice and Bob have to meet up an actual secret. We need a safer way to communicate online. Ever since I found out about pizza delivery, I've never wanted to leave the house. But I don't want Eve reading all of our messages. That stuff's really personal, you know? Well, what do you have in mind? How about this? Here's the alphabet, and we can shift each letter a certain number of places down the alphabet, and only we will know the shift, and our messages will be completely meaningless to Eve. So, what's the shift? I don't know, let's go with, 3? Now Bob can write out his message, replace each letter with the corresponding one in the key, and it will be completely meaningless to Eve. That is the most basic form of encryption. Now, hold on a second. Eve has a few tricks up her sleeve, too. She knows that languages have a frequency fingerprint. For example, with English, E is the most used letter, followed by T, then A. Here's the whole thing. Using this, she can easily decrypt Caesar ciphers without even having the key. She just has to compare the ciphertext's fingerprint with English's fingerprint. Looks like Alice and Bob need to come up with something better. So Alice and Bob meet up an actual secret again. Got any ideas? Actually, yeah. The problem with that cipher is that you've only got one shift to figure out, and there are clues like repeated letters and spaces all over the place. What if we did this? Take our message, and I need you to come up with some random numbers. We shift the letters like last time, but this time, every letter gets a different shift based on your numbers. Plus, we can add shifts in both the directions using negative numbers. Makes it more confusing. Now, like any good computer scientist, if I have to do math more than twice, I get a computer to do it for me instead. Here's the code I used for the one-time pad messages. Kids, if you love math, learn to code. If you hate math, definitely learn to code. I can guarantee that you'll love it. How am I supposed to read this nonsense again? You have the shift list, you dummy. That's the key. Just apply it in reverse. Bob can now send Alice encrypted messages, and Eve has absolutely no way of figuring out what it is, even if she had all the computing power in the world. This is why the one-time pad is an example of perfect secrecy. Ah, what are you doing here? This is my spot. Out, out, out! Sorry, I ran out of numbers and you told me not to message you otherwise. This is the problem with the one-time pad. It's inconvenient. Firstly, it requires access to truly random numbers, which are hard to come by. Also, the key has to be just as long as your message. Plus, keeping track of these really long keys and trusting someone else with them is really too much work. Let's move on to more modern forms of encryption. This is where it gets really ingenious. So far, we've only covered forms of symmetric key encryption, which means both parties share the same key. As you've noticed, this is problematic. Bob could accidentally or on purpose give Eve his copy of the key, endangering Alice's information, or vice versa. So, what's the solution? Using clever mathematical properties, you can come up with a method where you have separate keys to encrypt and decrypt. Think of the encryption key as a public padlock instead. You can use it to lock your information, but it doesn't open or decrypt anything. You can then have a private decryption key, which unlocks and opens that padlock. You don't share this key with anyone. This way, you don't have to trust them. Let's see how this works. Alice sends Bob her public lock, and Eve gets a copy of it too. Bob uses the lock to encrypt his data, plus an encryption key of his own. He sends this back to Alice, and Eve gets a copy of it as well. Eve can't do anything with it because she doesn't have Alice's private decryption key. The information is useless to her. But Alice, using her private key, can read it just fine. Now, if she wants to reply to Bob, all she has to do is encrypt her message using the key that Bob kindly included in his package and send it back over. Now, Eve gets a copy of this as well, but she can't decrypt it without Bob's key. There you have it. That's how computers can safely communicate today. You can view any website's security details in Chrome by clicking on that reassuring green lock. But how does this work exactly? How can a key be only used to encrypt and not decrypt? Okay, here's some of the math that you need to know to figure that out. Prime numbers are numbers that are only divisible by 1 and themselves without remainders. There are an infinite amount of these. Every other number is a product of some combination of these prime numbers. For example, we get 15 by multiplying the two prime numbers 3 and 5, and we get 182 by multiplying the prime numbers 2, 7, and 13. It's really easy to multiply big numbers. You can do it using Google. Here, let's try it. See? Barely a second. But given a really big number, it's insanely difficult to figure out what two or more numbers it is the product of. That property is what the RSA method is based on. Algorithms are basically a set of things that you do to get a certain type of result. I know that's super vague, but here are two sorting algorithms at work. The steps are different, but the result in this case is successfully sorting a list. So, let's get to it. Say you take two really big prime numbers. Let's say this one and this one. These two will make up the private key. Now, we multiply them and get this. This is your public key, meaning the jumbling algorithm depends on this. However, the algorithm is mathematically designed so that reversing it would require the use of these two numbers, which is almost impossible to figure out with just the public key. The only way you can reverse the jumbling is if you have these two numbers beforehand. That's the trick. The big number goes out to everyone, but the smaller numbers stay with you. Now, you still don't know the algorithm itself, and it's honestly too complicated to explain in a short video. But here's a quick example with really small numbers if you're dying to know. Ready, set, go. Alice picks two prime numbers, let's say 3 and 11. They multiply and give us 33. We use the 5 function on 33, which gives us 20. We then pick a public exponent e, which does not share a factor with 20. Let's say 7. We compute a private exponent d, which is the modular inverse of e. And this is nearly impossible unless you have your two private numbers. In this case, the modular inverse is 3. Now, the public key is 7 and 33. The private key is 3. Let's say Bob wants to send Alice his secret, which happens to be the number 2. He takes 2, raises it to 7, and uses the modulus operator with 33 to get 29. This is his encrypted message. Once she gets it, Alice can then decrypt it by raising 29 to her private exponent, 3, and then using the modulus operator with 33 to get back to 2. And that's how it's done. If that flew over your head, you're not alone. I didn't get it at first either. But if you want to understand it, check the description. And there are plenty of free resources on the web as well. So that's it. Now you know. We also need to talk about cybersecurity. Encryption's biggest weakness is human error. I'm sure you're thinking, if encryption is as perfect as you say it is, how come I see a headline about some website being hacked every day? That's because people aren't as good as math. Ethan at H3H3 has a great video about an attack on them. The attackers pretended to work for his cell service provider and convinced T-Mobile to give them Ethan's SIM card, which is one of the verification steps for accessing Ethan's YouTube account. They also used it to call Ethan's mom for what I can only assume are answers to his security questions. I mean, that's game over right there. Moms are the nicest people on earth. I don't even know why they bothered with the hacking. They should have just asked her to transfer all of Ethan's money into their bank account politely, and she probably would have done it. And then she would have invited those nice young men over for dinner that evening. A chain is only as strong as its weakest link. That link, in this case, happens to be people, who are really dumb, gullible, and careless when compared to computers. Other attackers often email people pretending to be from a company like Facebook or a bank, asking them to confirm their login details for some made-up reason. And people give it up. Sometimes websites, and you'd be surprised how often it's the popular ones, use software with known security holes. There's also bad passwords and verification steps for administrative access, and most importantly, some don't encrypt their data. Just because something is not linked to publicly does not make it a secret. I learned this the hard way when someone found and copied my code for one of my university assignments, because Pastebin's unlisted data can be found using something as simple as a clever Google search. I mean, that's so messed up because these guys clearly aren't capable hackers. They were failing a freshman year computer science assignment. But they still managed to steal my code. Look, legal decisions are being made about all of these things right now. If there's one thing that should convince you that encryption is safe, it's that the government wants a legal way around it. I'm sure you've heard about the FBI-Apple encryption dispute, where the FBI's case depends on a precedent from 1789. That's even before the first telegram was sent. Take a moment to let that sink in, okay? They're using a law that was written when the most sophisticated mode of travel was a horse with a good attitude. And they want to apply it in a time where you can touch a metal box in your hand, which will summon some dude from the internet who will take you wherever you want to go in a metal box on wheels that can drive itself. We don't force people to confess to crimes they've committed, because it's a really ugly practice when in place. We try to prove them guilty instead. It's way more fair. That means we as a society have decided that it's too far to have access to someone's mind. I know it seems reasonable to assume that if someone can access your house with a warrant, they should be able to access your phone and online accounts too. But it's not the same anymore, and here's why. It's a fact that these days, for most people, your phone knows more about you than you do. Access to someone's phone is worse than accessing someone's mind. And the line between your memory and your phone's memory gets blurrier and blurrier every day as technology improves. Quoting Grey again,
"Access to your phone today is unavoidably about access to your mind tomorrow."
It's important to think of encryption as an idea. For instance, a certain airplane can be unsafe. It can have malfunctioning parts, a bad pilot, terrible weather, not enough security at the airport, all causing it to crash. But airplanes as a whole, as a mode of transportation, are perfectly safe. An encryption algorithm can be flawed. A program running it can have bugs. The person managing the passwords can be gullible. The hard drive it's stored on can be corrupted. But encryption as a whole, as a security feature, is perfectly safe. I want to encourage you to be a part of the conversations about this topic. Voice your opinion. Make sure companies know that you won't stand for sloppy security. Call your service provider and tell them to never ever give access to your SIM card to anyone but you. Never send a stranger or even a representative your password by email for any reason. Encryption is just one link in the chain that makes up cybersecurity, and it's up to us to strengthen that chain and protect our data. I hope you learned something, and as far as these decisions are concerned, I hope you'll side with the people and companies trying to protect our privacy, and I hope that they're successful. Finally, I want you to get on your phone and order some food. Don't call anyone. Use an app or a website. Then, while your pizza or whatever is being delivered, think about the fact that your credit card info, your order, and address are kept safe using encryption. Think about the fact that because of this technology that you maybe knew nothing about, you can touch a metal box in your hand and use it to telepathically make food show up at your front door. So the next time you bite into some cheesy, delicious, home-delivered pizza, think about just how fudging amazing encryption really is.